We live in a dark and infinite universe. Of all the planets in our solar system, which occupies only a small part of the universe, most are unable to sustain life. The planets that can sustain life are located in the habitable zone. We'll return to this idea later. So then, what is the difference between Earth, a planet teeming with life, and the other planets? It's water. Every day we drink water to quench our thirst, and all forms of life need water to live. Let's learn about why water is so important for life, and explore some of the properties of water that make life possible. But first, let's take a short quiz. If we place water and metal in a hot place, which do you think will heat up faster? If you guessed metal, you're right. Metals have a lower specific heat than water. Specific heat is the amount of energy required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of a substance by 1 degree Celsius. This means that metals, which have a lower specific heat than water, heat up faster and water heats up more slowly. A large percentage of our body is made up of water. Due to the high specific heat of water, living things are able to maintain a steady body temperature. Another important characteristic of water is its ability to dissolve things. Water is able to dissolve almost anything thanks to this unique property. Water can create an environment in which all the substances needed for life can exist, evolve, and be dissolved. The human body is at least 70% water. Likewise, at least 70% of the Earth's surface is covered by water. Humans and the Earth have a lot in common. Earth, the planet of life. We have already briefly mentioned the habitable zone. This habitable zone is the area around a central star where water exists in liquid form. In our solar system, the central star is the Sun. The distance between the Earth and the Sun is 1 astronomical unit. Water vapor can be found on Venus, which is closer to the Sun than the habitable zone. There is likely ice on Mars, which lies beyond the habitable zone. Earth is the only planet in our solar system that is located in the habitable zone. Another name for the habitable zone is the Goldilocks zone. However, the habitable zone of a solar system doesn't always lie at 1 AU. The distance of a habitable zone from its central star depends on the mass of the central star. To better understand the concept of the mass of a central star, let's think of the Sun as a stove. A central star with a mass of 1 can be thought of as a normal stove, while a central star with a mass of less than 1 can be considered a small stove. A central star with a mass of greater than 1 can be thought of as a large stove. A large stove sends out a lot of heat, and this heat reaches greater distances than the heat of a smaller stove. This means that the habitable zone lies farther out and is wider when the central star is greater in mass. But a large stove also uses more energy. This means it consumes power faster and dies out faster, which means that there is not enough time for life to come into existence and evolve during the life of the star. So what happens when the central star is small in mass? A small stove sends out less energy than a large stove, meaning that the energy doesn't reach as far. This results in a habitable zone that is located closer to the central star. However, if the habitable zone lies too close to the central star, this poses a problem for life. Due to the pull of the central star's gravity, the speed of rotation of a planet in the habitable zone becomes similar to its speed of revolution. In other words, it is always daytime on one side of the planet. With no day and night, it is difficult for life as we know it to exist. So just because a planet is located inside the habitable zone does not necessarily mean that it can sustain life. Obviously, the Earth is a very unique case. There is one more thing that we need to remember. Just like humans, stars are born, grow, and eventually die. Our Sun is still young, and therefore it is stable. The light and energy of the sun is created in its core, where four hydrogen atoms become one helium atom through nuclear fusion. This hydrogen fusion reaction is currently stable in the sun. This allows the sun to maintain a constant size. At this stage, the stage in which a star is able to maintain its size, a star is called a main sequence star. Over time, the sun will grow larger and brighter, eventually becoming an old red giant. After about 5 billion years, the habitable zone will no longer be located at 1 AU. When the location of the habitable zone changes, there will no longer be liquid water on the Earth. It's also possible that the Earth will no longer exist. However, there is no need to worry. 5 billion years is a long time. Let's turn our attention back to Earth, our planet located in the habitable zone. How was the Earth born? Long ago, Earth was a planetesimal, which means small planet. Countless planetesimals began bumping into each other and fusing. During this process, some planetesimals gradually grew larger, and one of these larger planetesimals became the Earth. As these planetesimals continued to collide, the Earth heated up, and everything started to melt. The Earth was one sizzling ocean of magma. Due to the Earth's gravity and variations in the density of its magma, heavier substances collected at the center of the Earth, and lighter substances were pushed outward. At the center, a heavy core of iron and nickel was formed, while the outer crust was made up of lighter silicates, made up of silicon and oxygen. This division of the mantle from the crust is called stratification. The mantle then began to cool from the outside in, and the cooled mantle became the Earth's crust. At this time, fewer planetesimals were crashing into the Earth, allowing the surface to cool and form the primitive crust. Meanwhile, continued volcanic activity released large amounts of water vapor into the atmosphere. This water vapor turned into a liquid in the atmosphere in a process called condensation. The condensed moisture created clouds, and the clouds released moisture in the form of precipitation. The falling rain flowed to the lowest points on the crust, forming the primitive oceans. Finally, the planet reached a similar size and shape as it is today. Just like the Earth evolved into its current size and appearance, the Earth's atmosphere also underwent great changes. Today, the air we breathe is mostly made up of nitrogen and oxygen. However, when the Earth was young, the atmosphere was mostly made up of water vapor, carbon dioxide, methane, and ammonia. This was due to the volcanic gases that were created by the collisions between planetesimals. The biggest change that turned the primitive atmosphere into the air we breathe today was the decrease of carbon dioxide and the increase of oxygen. The carbon dioxide in the atmosphere dissolved into the primitive ocean. This carbon dioxide turned into calcium carbonate, which sank to the bottom of the ocean and formed limestone. In other words, carbon dioxide in the atmosphere moved into the hydrosphere, then into the geosphere. As carbon dioxide levels dropped, oxygen levels rose. This happened when cyanobacteria in the primitive oceans began photosynthesis. Let's take a look at how plant photosynthesis generates oxygen. Plants absorb water and carbon dioxide. Using sunlight, plants create glucose and oxygen. The glucose is converted into starch and stored in the leaves of plants, and oxygen is released into the atmosphere. This conversion process is known as photosynthesis, and through this process, oxygen levels in the atmosphere increased over time. This change in the atmosphere was crucial to the appearance of complex life forms. The primitive Earth was bombarded by cosmic rays and ultraviolet rays. These are powerful energetic particles that crash into Earth from space. Life cannot survive if it is exposed to these cosmic rays. However, the magnetosphere soon formed around the Earth, blocking these cosmic rays. in the primitive oceans, shielded from the still strong ultraviolet radiation, the first life forms were born. As mentioned previously, primitive life began with photosynthesis and the creation of oxygen. This oxygen then formed the Earth's ozone, which blocked ultraviolet rays and created an environment on land that allowed life to flourish. Today we covered how the Earth was born and how life came into existence. There were many steps involved in these processes. The birth of the Earth and life is every bit as magical and interesting as the birth of humans. We hope that today's lesson has helped you understand how our planet came into existence and how primitive life forms, our ancestors, were born. Next time, we'll talk about the ultimate disasters, volcanoes and earthquakes. Series of Why.